Azur, the first questioner is Reverend Vincent Price.
Right. Do they have to come all the way here? Didn't you arrange something in between, you know?
Yes, sir, the red
generally, chair. We do it in?
Yes, sir. The red chairs are the ones for the questioners.
Sure. Right. Please.
Sir, I work at Leicester University and at De Montfort University as a chaplain, as a Methodist chaplain. And as such, I'm very conscious, as I work closely with colleagues from other Christian denominations, of being a member of a minority group within the greater Christian tradition. I would be interested in your reflections this evening on the place and the treatment of religious minorities within Islamic societies, perhaps with specific reference to Saudi Arabia.
Thank you very much for this question. Islamic attitude to the non-Muslims as such is the fundamental question relating to this issue, because these small minor details will be covered if I answer that question. According to my understanding of the Holy Quran, and on this subject I'm absolutely clear, there is no religious form of government mentioned in the Holy Quran other than that which is based on absolute justice. And in relation to a government, or a government in relation to its subjects, is advised specifically and categorically that no government is permitted to treat people belonging to other faiths except with perfect equality and absolute justice. And the Holy Quran goes further by declaring that even if a people who do not belong to your religion have earlier transgressed against you just because of the difference of religion, yet you are not permitted to treat them without justice, treat them with absolute justice, and it is that which Allah likes. So with these two fundamental verses on the issue, I can't understand how the various Muslim governments can appropriate the right to work as God, and contrary to the Quranic teaching, start to treat minorities as having less civil rights than the Muslims of their country. On this issue, I have never received an answer from any mullah of the world proving me to be wrong here, because the Quranic verses are so clear that it's impossible for anyone to distort the meanings. So that in short covers everything that you have said, hasn't it? Hasn't it? Yes. Thank you.
So the next questioner is Mr. K. Krishna.
Azuriwala and friends, my name is Krishan Khanna, and my question is about Lord Krishna. We Hindus treat Lord Krishna as the creator, the preserver, and the destroyer of all beings. As he himself said, of all the creations, I am the beginning and the end and the middle. I am unborn and without beginning. Though I am the Lord of all sentient being, I still appear every millennium in my original transcendental form. And my question is...
Original transcendental form.
Transcendental form.
Right.
And my question is, how far this religious philosophy conforms to the philosophy of Islam. Thank you.
First of all, let me beg to differ with you as far as the interpretation of these lines are concerned. I have been a student of comparative religion. I found that every religion, however idolatrous it may appear to be to us today, was fundamentally a monotheistic religion. Because if you don't accept this universal principle, then the infights between religions will have no end whatsoever. And each religion will be understood to have emanated from a different source, different God. Now, as against this understanding of Veda, which you have presented to us, you should have remembered also that this is exactly what Jesus Christ said, that I am the Alpha, I am the Omega. And this is not only said by Jesus Christ, but also in the Holy Quran, there is mention of this truth that the Prophet Muhammad is the source and means of people reaching him. And when you say Khatam al-Nabiyyin, then Omega is understood. But in another hadith, tradition of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, he claims himself to be the very first. And according to the Muslim sects, all of them together, in view of some Quranic verses and these declarations by the Holy Prophet, he was the first to be born. Now the question is, here there are some translations made by you or somebody else which indicate that Krishna claims that he was never born, he is eternal. I have read Veda, now this, just a minute, Bhagavad Gita, myself, with deep attention. And I have discovered only evidence of truth and unity of God there. And Krishna himself only claimed to be a messenger, no more. For instance, his being, he's called Muralidhar. You know, he blows into the pipe. Apparently, the pipe is singing the song or raising the music, but there is breath behind it. Then he has more hands than ordinary people. And he has a body, well-defined body, but instead of two hands, he has four hands. And he also is known to have possessed wings. Now, what do these symbols, or if they are not symbols, the literal facts indicate? This is the question. As you said, he told us or gave us the glad tidings that every 1,000 years I would reappear in my original form. Is this the original form of God? Is this his entire geography, that within the space of a human stature, with four arms, he can be confined and disappear somewhere and begins to rule from there? Now, this is a very, very limited understanding of the nature of God which he has created. How could Lord Krishna say that? So there has to be some misunderstanding of reading him, of knowing what the message is. These understandings, misunderstandings do appear in every religion because of the specific religious terminology. For instance, wings. The Holy Quran also uses the word wings with relation to angels. But the Holy Quran makes it specifically clear that no body has wings to fly with. Only the wings are indicative of attributes. So if there are two arms, the attributes are half the number of such person who has four arms. The angels grow in attributes, and in this world they have four wings according to the Quran, but in the hereafter they will have 8 wings. And they are all terminologies, all terms and or metaphorical figures, let's say. For instance, Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallam himself is told that you lower your wing of mercy over those who believe you. Then the people are told to lower their wings over their parents. So these usages of the same word wing elsewhere in the Quran makes it very clear to us that they are just terms which have been misunderstood and misapplied. So according to Ahmadiyya belief, Hadhrat Krishna was a holy messenger of Allah. He used a language of symbols to convey to the world of the period some truths. And if you read it, the Bhagavad Gita in detail, it's not just an account of war between two factions. It in reality is a masterpiece of description of evil, goodness pitched against evil, or evil pushed against, put against goodness. A battle between darkness and light. Now turn to Zoroastrianism. What Zarathustra says, or Zoroaster says, is again the same thing in different terms. He speaks of fire against darkness, and he makes fire the symbol of truth, which is God, and darkness the symbol of falsehood, which is devil. But you find the same mention in the Bible, in the Holy Quran, but there they do not mean that evil had a separate entity in itself and emanated from a God who was independent of God of goodness. So these are terminologies found in every religion. It's our duty not to be confused by them and come to a reasonable, sensible understanding whereby we could reconcile the world religions as having been emanated from the same one single source of God. So I hope that should be sufficient, because otherwise if we go into further debate on this issue, I think it would not be profitable. Right?
That would be it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So the next question is Mr. Jiriullah of Leamington Spa.
Yes, Mr. Jiriullah?
Birmingham.
Birmingham. MashaAllah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullah.
If I may say, you're looking
good. I thought this was not an African style name, Jiriullah.
It isn't. It's a name that you gave me yourself, that I prayed for.
That is why I want you to be introduced to them.
Okay.
Jiriullah is originally from Caribbean islands or where?
Jiriullah. My name, my original name.
No, original country.
Oh, my country is Nigeria.
Nigeria, oh,
yeah,
right.
Nigeria.
But you were born here in England, weren't
yeah, that's
you?
Right, that's right,
that's right. And you were Christians prior to becoming an Ahmadi Muslim.
Yeah, that's right.
Right?
Yeah.
That is why I had to change your name at your request from the previous one to Jiriullah.
Yeah, that's right.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. Please.
Thank you. My question today, from my understanding and my reading of both the Holy Bible and the Holy Quran,
yes,
is that second to Allah Almighty, we should put parents first. But my question is phrased in a sense that although we should always respect parents and honor parents and their wishes and their guidance, is there any cause, I mean, it's more of a personal question, is there any time and any cause then we should probably have the opportunity to disagree, and with exception to faith, such as on social and material matters?
Yes, first of all, please you can wait there.
Okay.
You're a young man, strong leg. Now, the question has to be rectified a little bit. It has wrong premise on which it is standing it for the moment. Okay. You said, according to the Holy Quran and the Holy Bible, after God, there are parents. While, according to my study, after God, they are prophets of Allah. Those who represent Allah. So, after God, if you qualified by including the prophets in what is godly and which is representative of God, then I agree with this statement, okay. Not otherwise.
Okay.
And when you understand this question as raised in this modified form, then you are also answered that if God and those who represent Him must be given priority over all others, then parents automatically belong to the top of the second group, which when confronts this first category, will lose its validity. So you accept the instruction from your parents. Also the Holy Quran speaks of the government and authority and says whatever government is established, you must obey that government, the parents, etc. But whenever there is a difference of opinion between one authority and the other, then always follow Allah and His Prophet.
Okay.
So the issue is resolved.
My question, it's more relating to material and social matters rather than the religious side.
My answer covers that as well, because in ordinary matters, worldly matters, you will not find any contradiction between religion and the wishes of the parents. So I qualified my answer with that, you know.
Yeah,
so it's already answered.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So the next question is Mrs. Russell. Mrs. Russell.
Mrs. Russell, right.
Your Holiness, I would like to ask this question. Do you think it's essential to Islam that animals should be slaughtered by the halal method, or do you think it's just arisen from the conditions of the Middle East when there was no refrigeration?
I'll explain that. You see, the question again has to be explained. Question itself has to be explained first. I'm going to do it for you. You see, when you hear of halal and haram much talked about in a society like the British society, and when you hear the edicts of some mullahs that do not eat any meat slaughtered by non-Muslims, then you have an image of what Islam is all about, and perhaps you understand Islam to be dividing a line between people of Islam and others in areas of daily common usage which are common. Now, this is not the correct understanding of Islam. Islam clearly lays down those things which are forbidden for human consumption. And among those things which are counted in the Quran are the flesh of swine, those animals which died a natural death, those who died out of an accident, those who were strangled to death, and all such animals who were slaughtered with the name of anyone else than anyone other than Allah. So if they were slaughtered to the altar of some imaginary gods, then that flesh becomes positively haram for Muslims. In all the cases, in the rest of the cases, also those animals which are birds or animals of prey, which eat other animals' flesh, they are also forbidden in Islam, and you can't eat their flesh. Apart from that, the Holy Quran says the food of the Jews and the Christians alike, Al-Kitab, is halal for you. I don't know why the mullahs shut their eyes to this verse, because the way they understand the Quran, this verse has nothing to do in the Quran. Why should it be there? It's a very broad-minded teaching. It says of all Ahl-e Kitab, and this again is a very interesting point raised by the Quran, because Ahl-e Kitab are generally confined to the followers of Moses and Jesus Christ and those who stood in between. But the literal term Ahl-e Kitab applies to all religions which were founded on a divine book. So as such, I believe that the Hindus who do not indulge in idolatry, they should also be treated as Ahl-e Kitab, because they are founded on the book of Krishna, whom we understand to be a law-bearing prophet. So with this understanding, I assure you that this is the Ahmadiyya belief and practice, that all meat is halal provided it is slaughtered for the sake of human consumption. It is slaughtered in a manner whereby blood is let, because blood is haram, not the flesh. If it is not strangulated, if it is not beaten to death, then that flesh of the animal, which animal in itself is not forbidden, that can be eaten without any shadow of doubt. Only what you have to do is say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, before you eat the flesh. Now, this is not only my interpretation of the Quran, this is proved to be the practice, the sunnah of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, because we read in Bukhari, no other book than Bukhari, it is the most authentic book of traditions, that Hazrat Rasulullah sallam told some others who were doubtful about the quality of meat which they received from the Bedouins around, whether it was properly slaughtered or not, or whether it was slaughtered by Muslims or others, Muhammad Rasulullah sallam said, no, don't indulge in doubts and speculations. If a meat comes, it is slaughtered for human purpose, then say your own Bismillah over it. And Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, doesn't cost anybody anything. It just means, in the name of Allah, and Allah is the greatest. So this is the true nature of Islamic injunction regarding the foods. Do you have any question based on this statement, please?
Just add that I understand exactly what you said, yes. A lot of people are worried about the actual method of slaughter, you see, and the stunning of an animal first seems to be in some way a little kinder than killing the animal and letting it go.
I'll agree with that. You see, this issue is debatable, whether to stun the animal first and then to slaughter is more benign for the animal, more shows more kindness to the animal, or just the slaughter. Because I have studied this since my student days here in 1956, and I went to some slaughterhouses, I inquired from the way, from the people concerned, and because I know some of the basic sciences concerned in this question, I assure you that it cannot be definitely proved that the stunning does not hurt the animal, and it makes the death easier for the animal, and slaughter is a more cruel way. Because in Islamic system of slaughter, the artery, main artery, is severed immediately. You know, that sharp, and also the Holy Prophet has emphasized that you must never use a blunt instrument for doing this. And when the artery is severed, immediately with a sharp weapon, like sharp instrument, then the blood supply to the mind, to the brain, is stopped therewith. And you think the animal is writhing in pain or this and that, it is writhing all right, but throughout automatic reflexes, not in pain. And that is why the Holy Prophet repeatedly admonished Muslims not to slaughter animals any other way by cutting them piecemeal, for instance. You have no right to do that. Do it this way, and then they immediately lose consciousness. Right? Thank you.
So the next questioner is Mr. Saraj. Mr. Saraj, I believe. That's
right.
Sorry, have I got it wrong? My apologies.
Well, he would pronounce his own name better than anybody else. Please.
Dear sir, my name is Sheriff Irfan.
Sheriff Ullah Khan.
Sheriff Irfan.
Sheriff?
Sheriff Irfan.
Ullah?
Irfan. Khan.
No?
Sheriff Irfan.
Oh, Irfan.
Irfan.
I see. Do you hail from Africa?
No, my parents from Cyprus.
From Cyprus?
That's right.
A Turkish Muslim originally?
Turkish Muslim, yes.
I see. Now I understand. Even it's difficult for me to understand the pronunciation of Muslim, familiar Muslim names, which have changed in its pronunciation considerably in some cases. When spoken by the Turks. So, Cypriot Turks or whatever it is, your name is obviously a Muslim name, but pronounced in a manner that is difficult for me to comprehend, right? I'm explaining it to apologize why I took specific interest in this. I want to understand, you know, what it was. Thank you very much.
Thank you. My question is, does the Ahmadiyya Jamaat relate to Sufism?
To
Sufism.
Sufism?
That's right.
Now, what is Sufism? Do you know?
Well, I have very brief knowledge of Sufism. I just wanted to know if it...
No, but when you ask a question about Ahmadiyya Jamaat and Sufism,
yes.
What message will be delivered to you if you don't know what Sufism is?
Well, my understanding of Sufism, it came after the advent of Sayyidina Muhammad, and was and because it was after the advent of the Holy Prophet, does it really relate to Islam itself, actually?
You know, can I help you in explaining Sufism first?
Please.
So the answer becomes understandable by others, eh? And you as well. Please sit down. You see, Sufism is in fact relates to all that is cryptic. Now, when a religion speaks of form of worship, it speaks of how you bear yourself, how you wash yourself, how you stand before God, and what you do and what you do not. This is a form of the religion, which is called Sharia or law. The Jews, for instance, paid such great emphasis on the law that according to Jesus Christ, ultimately, they wasted all their attention upon the shell and forgot to fill it with the spirit, which was more essential. So this is what led to St. Paul rejecting form altogether. And that is what has led Sufism in Islam to shift away from the path of Hazrat Muhammad to an imaginary world of their own, whereby they thought the form was not essential. So what they did was, they did not create a demarcation line between Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the prophets earlier, like St. Paul drew a line between Jesus Christ and all the prophets before him. But they said both should be kept. As far as Prophet Muhammad is concerned, he's fine, he's all right. But when he emphasized form, what he really meant was that you should go for the spirit. And they argued in a very strange way that if you have the spirit, for instance, if you drink the milk, Why to keep the bottle? Now, this argument is fine.
If,
and if there is a big if involved, you want to have the last of that milk and no more. If you must need to drink milk again and again and again, then you can't chuck away the bottle at all. Some bottle will be needed. So spirit cannot survive without form. Although it is not the form which is intended, it is the spirit which is intended. So that is why deviation began to occur in Islam between Sufism and Mullahism. Now unfortunately, after around 300 years or so, this bifurcation became very broad. Both deviated to the different directions until they could not even communicate with each other. That link was broken. Sufis said the mullahs are wrong. We do not need to say the prayer the way it was said before. And the mullah said Sufis had abandoned Islam and they believe in some spiritual experiences of there and call it Islam, of which they have no right. So that is why some Sufis were practically put to gallows and ultimately hanged to death because their claims, their slogans were so mystic that the mullah could not understand them. And the mullah thought that it is a claim which totally negates Islam. Like Al-Hallaj Mansur, who was hanged to death by the mullahs, he went to the gallows crying till the last, Analhaq, Analhaq, Analhaq. This is Sufism. I am the truth, I am the truth, I am the truth. Now if somebody says that to indicate that I have lost my own identity totally to the truth, you can't differentiate between me and God in the sense that I follow Him so totally that I have lost my independent identity, then it is not a shirk at all. It is nothing wrong. There is nothing wrong with it. This is the claim made by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself and about him in the Holy Quran. Ma ramayta is ramayta walakinna Allah rama. O Prophet of Allah, when you threw the handful of pebbles at the enemy, it was not you, it was God who did it. Is there any teachings of idolatry of two, three gods in that? Obviously, what was meant and will always be understood to be so was that the Holy Prophet had completely lost his own ego and submitted it to the higher will of Allah. So there is no need for any bifurcation of this faith into two different religions. If Sufism has a different entity than that of the Holy Prophet of Islam, then the moment you accept it, you negate the Prophet of Islam. If it has the same entity, then why any Sufism or any Mullahism at all? Then what you should return to is the image of the Holy Prophet of Islam, which was not split in the middle. He was a balanced person, so perfectly balanced that the Holy Quran gives the Holy Prophet this compliment that he was a man who was inclined neither to this side nor to that side. He belonged neither to the east nor to the west. So with this poise and this perfect balance between right and wrong and darkness and light, you don't need to split yourself into two different personalities. Now why Sufism began to become popular, particularly in Turkey, is a very important question. Also, it became very popular in USSR. for different reasons, of course. But in Turkey, it became popular because of Hanafism and Hanafi mullahs who became very strict on form. So there were Sufis who loved God, who really went for the spirit of religion. They drew some followings from underneath the mullahs to themselves and said, look here, what is needed is love of God, love of humanity. If you do not have this, then all your exercises are vain, meaningless. So leave the mullahs and come to me. Like Maulana Rome, for instance, a great Sufi. But never did he abandon saying prayers. This is the point which I'm coming to. So in the beginning, Sufism was absolutely right. But when the followers of Sufism began to saw with squinted eyes, began to see with squinted eyes and saw two images instead of one, it was there that the damage was done, and from then on there was no coming back to the truth. Right? Thank you.
Thank you. I hope I get the name right this time. The next question is Mr. K. Chanda.
Mr. K. Chandan, please.
Assalamu alaikum. I come from Leamington Spa.
From?
Leamington Spa.
From Spa, right.
Mr. Gafoor, Mr. Gafoor is, he was my close friend. And the question which I have already prepared was asked by my sister.
Is that right?
Yeah. But fortunately, I have written another question, if you don't mind.
Please do. Of course, you're most welcome.
And, my question is this: why Muslim ladies, Ahmadiyyas, are not allowed to pray in the same room?
No, they are allowed. Who told you this? They are allowed to say the prayer in the same room because the Holy Prophet ﷺ himself permitted them to say their prayers and in the same hall.
Yeah, and the Sunnis, they get together in the same room, I don't know well.
No, they don't. On the contrary, you just reverse the positions. The Sunni Muslims, practically nowadays, I mean, not all maybe, but majority, the majority among them, do not believe that the Muslim ladies should say their prayer in the same hall, which is reserved entirely for men, not for ladies. Although the scholars, the great scholars among all sects of Islam know very clearly that at the time of the Holy Prophet, separate halls were not built. And ladies used to say their prayer, but behind men. Not in front.
Not in front, because we...
Yes, the reason is obvious. You see, when you go to pray to God, and women are prostrating before you, or mending and doing this and that, it's very likely that men whose sights are generally wavered, they begin to be diverted from God to the ladies in front. And that will also be an insult to the ladies. So it's a very wise injunction. And it's a compliment to the ladies. They know how to behave. And they know how to where to look and where not to. So it is not an insult to stand behind here. In this particular context, comparative lack of trust is shown in men, and I think very rightly so. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, please. Yes, yes.
So the next questioner is a Mr. Akin.
A king or a king?
Mr. Akin is the name I have.
It's okay. Akin. Is he here?
It's
him. Oh, sorry.
Acha.
In that case,
prior to his being Jariullah, he was aching.
Oh, I see.
Is that right?
Yes. Okay. I've got two names down. There are three questioners left. The next questioner is Mr. Neville Stack.
Yes, please.
So, some of us here are involved in the communications industry, and therefore my question is based on the remarkable, even astonishing spread of Ahmadiyya throughout the world at incredible speed. The question is, how does it happen? How do people know about it?
Thank you very much, yes. You see, Ahmadiyya community claims to be a community planted by God Himself or created by God Himself to fulfill the prophecy which is mentioned in the Holy Quran, that the faith of Islam will ultimately emerge victorious over all other faiths. So, according to the Holy Quran, in the latter days, there was to be the advent of Prophet Muhammad, not in the same person, but in the form of a follower. So we do not understand that literally at all, nor does the Quran permit it. So the Holy Quran, Prophet had to come again in the form of a servant of his who would restart the movement of Islam spreading over the whole world. So this is the claim of the community. Now, we have lost so much time, 1300 years, in comparison to many other Muslim sects, and to the issue with us was how to move fast enough, not only to capture the imagination of others, but also the Muslims. So the pace had to be tremendously bigger and larger and more effective. So we started doing it through literature. We have been able to publish the translations of the Holy Quran so far into 52 languages of the world, major languages of the world, and making it available for almost every nation, because these 52 major languages are understood largely and read and printed in so many countries. English, for instance, German, Spanish, French, and Chinese. So in all major languages of the world, Japanese of course, Turkish, Korean, and so on and so forth, Hindi, Sanskrit, all the major languages. Now we can boast, we can take genuine pride in the fact that we have been able to serve the cause of Islam and the cause of humanity by making the Quran available to almost all the world. But the plan would be complete after we reach the 100, for which the preparation is on way, and many a translation is in the pipeline at the moment. So within the next a few years, I suppose, I hope, we'll be able to reach the figure of 100. Although Christianity can claim much larger number of languages in which Bible has been translated, but I have gone into detail and pursued those languages right to the country and the areas where they're spoken. And I was surprised to find that most of the people belonging to those languages cannot read or write. You see, so it was an effort practically lost, and they could not create any impact as far as the language went. I think they went for the number, and that was also well intended, I hope. So in that regard, I discarded the scheme of competing with Christianity just for the sake of hollow numbers. He said the purpose is that the man, wherever he is, he should understand the message of the Quran in his own language, which, or in a language to which he is familiar. So in that way, 100 languages, which we have very carefully chosen, will cover the need of the entire mankind. But that also was very slow. The problem we faced was that large areas of the Muslim world particularly were made unavailable and inaccessible to Ahmadiyya community for our message. In Pakistan, where from which I hail, you see, it is forbidden to publish any book of Hazrat Masih Maud al-Islam, the founder of the community, or to address any other Pakistani with the message of Ahmadiyyat. It is punishable by at least 3 years rigorous imprisonment if any Ahmadi attempts to do it. In the Arab world, almost everywhere, whenever an attempt was made to send our literature across through mail or personally, it was always stopped at the ports, at the post offices. And we simply couldn't do anything. So my predecessor thought of going for radio. And this was his dream, his ambition, that we should have communication through radio so that we could reach the largest number of people. Now, when I attempted to fulfill his wish, I realized that the days of radios are fast buried in the past, although it is still a live instrument of conveying the ideas. In many areas, it is very effective, in fact. But the problems which we faced were manifold. Number one, it was a thing of the past. Already it has been almost written off, because through satellite television, the world is being hooked onto this new system where they could see a thing and hear a thing together. But apart from that, there were extreme managerial problems, because different countries had very strict laws on the radio transmissions, and the power which was needed to have a world radio also required a base where to install that. And no country was ready to grant us this permission. So I said, why not television? And then we started working for it. Fortunately, it so happened that when this desire was born and it took real shape of a determination, just during those days, Russia fell to the outside world and crumbled down, and the Berlin Wall also was demolished, and there was no drawing line separating the free world and the so-called enslaved world. And with that, a large number of their satellites became redundant and without any purpose. So they very quickly wanted to go to the world market for joining this satellite system of television production. Now, for us it was made possible just because of that. Otherwise, the prices we had to pay to the rest of the regular international companies were forbidding, absolutely impossible for us within our means to go for any television station with the help of these other satellite companies. You know, there were in some cases there were 20 times more. So although some of the satellites available started wobbling, and from time to time you had to change your antennas to different directions, but overall they provide us excellent service at a very cheap rate. So then when we gained the know-how, because all the workers involved were volunteers, none was paid, we did not only gain the know-how in England, but we also gained the know-how in the rest of the world where Ahmadiyyat is established. In all European countries, in America, in Canada, in Far Eastern countries and so on. So people became interested in antennas and changing the direction and making their own dishes cheaply. In Africa, for instance, we couldn't afford to buy the dish antennas from the market. because we had to pay 10 times more the prices. So I sent technicians there who had learned the art of making perfect parabolas, and they started teaching Africans how to build antennas, dish antennas, etc. So practically, this necessity of spending least and gaining most of the gains out of that small spending trained us. If we were rich enough to go to the market, very few Ahmadis would really bother to get more information about it and learn the knowledge in depth. So now we have thousands of Ahmadis prepared in the world who by themselves have studied this and are capable, with the grace of Allah, of linking their own hand personally made dishes with any satellite in the world. So here's Nasir Shah. Sayyid Nasir Shah, where is he? He is an example. Sayyid Nasir Shah is gone? Huh? Just. Well, he will not belong, doesn't belong, he is from Birmingham, isn't he? But he didn't know the ABC of science and these things. Prior to my entrusting him with the task of finding an alternative, I mentioned him because the second phase begins from here. After dealing with Russians for a time, we realized they were the rather wonky people, you know, difficult to work with. And they began to hurt us with the knowledge that perhaps we were in their pockets. We couldn't go to the open market anyway. So I told Nasir Shah to start looking right and left and as far away from here as possible, even to go to the American markets and their satellites, to somehow find out if we can have an alternative to Russian satellites. And he taught himself, first of all. He had no knowledge. When he used to telephone me, oh, what can I do, what should I do, I told him. He said, but I don't understand these things. I said, you will come. I didn't understand them either. So let's go together, help each other. And within the last 10 months or so, he has acquired so much knowledge that when the experts from other companies come, they are amazed at his amount, his a store of knowledge which he has in his heart and mind. So this is how it was made possible to abandon the Russian satellites and shift over to the most modern satellite system of Americans. And it resolved many problems for us, largely the money. Because the system we chose for us was not cheap, popular, a cheap popular system to which generally the satellites were hooked. Because the satellites in the world most often are hooked on to such television as provide cheap programs, luxurious programs, and programs to destroy human morals. So they are a big company, sort of wholesalers. They sell their time much cheaper to these companies and don't go for their own programming. So we said, because our clientele would definitely hook on to our satellites, whether they are popular or not, it wouldn't make any difference, provide the service is excellent. So that is what we needed. So at slightly higher price we paid to Russians, we got perfect service and global service because of this wholesale industry, you know. And people would be amazed how little we spend on this in comparison to other companies, single companies. Even one single company based in India spends at least 20-30 times what we do to provide this service to the whole world. The secret lies in voluntary work. You see, to get a space on satellite or a transponder is comparatively much cheaper than to prepare programs. For each hour sometimes you have to pay £100,000 or $150,000, and to keep a station working for 24 hours with variety almost every day is a very expensive thing. But in the course of this experience, we have launched voluntary companies who make programs voluntarily without charging the Jamaat a single penny. They do it with such zeal. For instance, in Germany, they make German programs. In America, they make American programs. In Canada, the Canadian programs. They don't charge a single penny from the Jamaat they serve, but in fact, they pay from them their own pockets. They foot the bills of their personal, you know, travels, etc., etc. So people think we are very rich, have to be fabulously rich community to go for the whole world service. But the secret lies in dedication and sincerity. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. So there are two more questions, possibly a third if we have time.
Fine.
So we have two more questions, possibly a third, depending upon whether you wish to take the third.
Oh, I'm free. I'm available.
The next question is Mr. Raju V.S.
Please do. Mr. Raju Dutt? Did you say Raju Dutt?
No.
No.
My name is Raju Vyas.
Raju Vyas. Yes,
I'm a freelance journalist, Azur.
Yes, I know. Vyas is a Sri Lankan name. I've been there many times.
No, Vyas are Hindu. No? The great Vyas, V-Y-A-S.
I see. Right.
I'm Hindu by religion.
You, sir, you're not Tamil. I beg your pardon? You're not Tamil.
No, I'm Gujarati Hindu from India. Right. You, sir, are heading a very difficult task, in my view, in a very pressed time. You are swimming against the tide. How do you get the strength? How do you preach the strength? Do you have any fear? And how do you give strength to your followers from the other Muslims who do not accept you, sir?
Thank you. Well, swimming against time is the most important part of your question. But those who swim against the tides, they always change the tides if they're right. So gradually, the swimming becomes less arduous and easier as you proceed, because the times change along with you. All the prophets of God who founded a religion, all the law-bearing, not only law-bearing, but founders of religions, started swimming against the time single-handed, alone by themselves. And what happened? The tides were changed. And it is that history from which we draw our strength. You said strength, where you get the strength? Strength can only be drawn from faith. Faith born on the hard facts of history or hard facts of nature. The rest of the faiths are just faiths and no more. They can't even change the lives of those who hold those faiths. And this is the dilemma of the present world. So this is how you can recognize Ahmadiyyat as standing out differently from the community of other religions. Otherwise, just we are one of so many. Why should you be interested in us, not in others? And this is the line of demarcation which you have suggested to me, that we are strong in faith, so much strong that we can adhere to faith, the faith, so faithfully, despite the fact that we have to offer sacrifices of our lives, of our properties, of our honor, continuously over a large number of years. Consistently we have been doing it. So that is an indication that we do have faith. And the faith must be founded on something. It has to be truth. Otherwise, the faith which are founded on fantasies can work for a while, you know. They create a stir. But that is only an infatuation, it's not love. It doesn't last. Faith, the true faith, is the lasting motive force which drives humans to an end with a purpose. So the last 100 years of Ahmadiyya has proved it already, that we have stood the tests of times. In Pakistan, you know, it is punishable by death to declare La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Did you know that? To claim that Allah is one and Muhammad is his prophet and servant. If an Ahmadi makes this claim, it is punishable by death under 295C, which would not permit even for such a criminal to be bailed out. Because this is the crime of the gravest nature according to the law of Pakistan now, fully supported by the Supreme Court's decisions. Now, something is happening which is so strange. Something is happening which never happened before in the history of human persecution, religious or otherwise. Now, you find persecution everywhere in the world. Why? Because some people dare to disagree with you. Not because they dare to agree with you. So here is something new added to the history of human persecution. Of course you hear of so much persecution in Russia, persecution of those who would disagree with communist philosophy, right? But I never read Stalin punishing or anybody else, torturing somebody for the fact that he fully agreed and endorsed the views of communism. The same is depicted by the history of Christianity during the 300 years before Dark Ages, when in many countries of Europe, Christians were persecuted for holding different views from Christianity as was understood by the dominant society. Never before you would find an example of a people gone so mad, so but there has to be some reason. After all, other things of life, they are not bad. And when you understand the reason, there, at the same moment, you understand the truth of Ahmadiyya community. They tried their best to stem the tide. They took all possible measures to stop the passage of Ahmadiyya and failed. So now they say, that is the only way out. Punish them for agreeing with the fundamentals of Islam so that if they deviate, then the Muslims will stop following them. If they do not, then they lose their lives. Now, this is the dastardly plan which ultimately has been put into action through legal help, through legislation, because it's the ultimate of acceptance of defeat. Ahmadiyya has to be so true, so strong, so powerful, that still it continues to flourish in Pakistan. Not a day has dawned since, not a sun has set on Pakistan when Ahmadiyya did not flourish on and on and on, you know, progressed from strength to strength. So this is exactly what happened in the early periods of Christianity. And that is what we present to the Christians as a proof of Jesus reborn, not in person, but in spirit, in character. Because this is the essence of Christianity. If somebody slaps you on one cheek, offer the other one. And this, according to Jesus Christ, was far more powerful instrument of battle with the falsehood than raising sword against sword. And we have proved it. In Pakistan, I do not permit Ahmadis to retaliate because the founder of the Ahmadiyya community did not permit us to retaliate with the same coins. So what we are doing is patience and patience, and tell them to, all right, beat the life out of us if you may, if you can. But you can't beat the faith out of us, with the grace of Allah. Thank you.
So the penultimate question.
This is the last and
last but one.
Yes. Okay. I'll be short, a brief next time, inshallah.
Mr. Brian,
some of the guests may have been tired, you know, sitting for long. Please.
Exactly. Mr. Brian Rogers of Birmingham, please.
Yes, please.
Good evening, Azul.
How do you do?
Very well, thank you. My question refers to technology of the day. With the advancement of technology, for example, carbon dating, ground x-rays, DNA and the like, how far along the technology road do we go for fear of exposing some of the legends and stories that may affect our religious beliefs, as ignorance is sometimes bliss?
Well, what is technology? Technology is the understanding of the creative plan of God and to follow it as much as you can. And you can never become creative unless you run along the direction of God's creation. This is the basic philosophy of science. There cannot be anything wrong whatsoever in imitating God in His creation, provided that it is carried out for good purposes. If it is done to frustrate the spiritual plan of God, that would be putting His creation against His word. Then of course it will not be permitted. Otherwise this technology is most welcome. And Ahmadis pay very great stress on education, and women in particular, because they have been withheld from getting higher education by some of the orthodox mullahs, unfortunately against the teachings of Islam. But our standard of education in women, or at least literacy, is so high that Rabwa is the one town in Pakistan where Ahmadi women are 100% literate, while the rate of literacy in the country for women would be less than 8%. And we go for education all over the world, and we try to create atmosphere which would be promotive for higher education for our children. We tell them to abstain from vain luxuries of the world. They don't drink, they don't go to the pubs or dancing floors, and they don't chase skirts. I hope so. In some cases I know, you know, some odd man here and there would do. Nobody can guarantee anything about the youth. So I don't want to make any false statements, false impression on you. Some Ahmadi youths I know deviate, but comparatively much less.
May I add a little bit?
Yes, please.
I was referring mainly to the Shroud of Turin and the after effects of the exposure to it being fake.
To white? I couldn't follow the question, please. Would you help me?
About the Turin
Shroud. In the beginning I thought that.
Yeah,
but then
the reference
you started talking of technology.
The technology was referring to the carbon dating and the technology that allows people to expose things that we believe. And
sorry for following a completely different avenue from what which was intended by you for me to follow. Now, on Turin Shroud, there is a version of Catholic Church in particular, who appointed or permitted certain top scientists to work on Turin Shroud, and they published their findings, which were contrary to the beliefs earlier held about the Turin Shroud. Many another scientist stood up against this. And they have written books on this. I've got those books with me. I've read them. And they proved positively that it was a conspiracy against truth. Because if the finding of the Turin Shroud is accepted to be totally true, then there is no room for Trinity left in Christianity. then the truth of Jesus Christ can only be understood in his being a messenger of God. Then there is no truth left in his revival from the dead. Because the person who was wrapped in the Turin shroud was living and breathing and bleeding. And a dead man could not do that. So the evidence of breath with ammonia, with carbon dioxide, and evidence of blood smudging the cloth all around is a definite testimony that the man who was wrapped in this shroud was still alive and breathing. You see, I have to explain this last bit because many people may not be familiar with this issue. If a man dies in this position standing upright, then the blood from his wounds must flow downwards. The blood from his wounds cannot make a smudge, a round smudge, around the center of the prick. It can only happen when such a man is wrapped while lying prone and continues to bleed. And that is the story of the two-inch shroud, which hurts so many and makes so many so worried. So other scientists, again Christians, all of them, they protest against this sort of investigation, and also they prove that the carbon dating is not as defined and as precise as you let the world understand. They have proved from scientific inquiry that carbon dating could be off the mark by 1,000 years. So for them to say that Turin shroud could not be traced back beyond 1200 years because of carbon dating is invalid anyway. It doesn't make any sense. I mean, it doesn't prove anything. Moreover, the presence of the pollen, grass pollen, on the Turin shroud, which is found in abundance in Palestine and not elsewhere in the world, was pointed out by these scientists. They said, but how do you read that? And how would you explain the fact that this style of weaving was popular in that 100 year in which Jesus came and went? It was not in existence before, was not continued after him. So they pointed many fingers at the fact of crucifixion and the circumstances in which it took place, and the facts relating to Jesus Christ and the times of Jesus Christ. But over and above this, there is one point which is completely baffling for those scientists who would like us to draw different conclusions. The fact that if it was a fake, then the fake must have been done by a foul person who was attributing a fake thing to Jesus Christ and earning some worldly gains out of that. He had to be an artist of some type. But how on earth could he fake an image which was negative? Completely negative image. I have never read a scientist answer this question, except those who agree with the genuineness of the Turin shroud. They say yes, and they have attempted to show and prove that through natural means, camera-like effect could be produced, and they have demonstrated it. Particularly, they draw our attention to the fact that the 12 ingredients of the ointment which was rubbed over the body, injured body of Jesus Christ, contained such elements as when applied to a plate of glass even today and exposed to any image through a pinhole, for instance. The image which would be created on this glass would be a negative image. So under what circumstances that makeshift camera was invented by God or organized by God, they suggest, for instance, the fact, first of all, the ointment had some photosynthetic material. Second, the fact that the reserves in the terrain there, underground minerals, were rich in two things in particular, sulfur and ammonium sulfate. Ammonium sulfate has been exported from Palestine for so many years until artificial manure was synthesized. That was the main source of this manure, because the area below is rich in that. And when these they decompose, they create ammonia, and sulfur fumes also play a role. So the scenario they have built is that when Jesus was kept in the sepulchre, a stone was placed over it, and there was darkness. So he perspired there, because when you apply ointments to the wounds, naturally you also perspire. So the urea which was excreted from this perspiration also played a vital role in making the whole material photosynthetic. Then we read in the New Testament and from other accounts that due to earthquake shocks, the stone was removed to a degree, not entirely, from the opening of the cave, and then after a while it came back and fitted on that. Sunlight must have entered then. There was no need for a pinhole or lens camera, because the material of the cloth was sticking next to his body. So any light penetrating from outside into that material must have created a negative image. How to fix it? This is the question. Because there has to be a fixer for guaranteeing that further light and further exposure would not destroy the image created under circumstances. So they have proved, the scientists demonstrated, that if sulfur fumes appear afterwards, they would stabilize the compound into a non-photosynthetic compound. And the evidence is abundant that during the earthquake, sulfur fumes also were emitted by the earth. So they say this is the nearest to what we can believe scientifically. Whatever other position you take, it is absolutely unjustifiable, because then you have to involve a fake artist born hundreds of years before camera was invented. And they say even now, when the camera is invented, no living artist can make a negative image of a person sitting before him. It's impossible. Very minute shades and changes, subtle changes in the negative image defy an artist to produce negative out of a sitting person before them. So they say this is a certainty. It was not a fake. If you ask how it could have happened, we suggest this. If you find some fault with the suggestion, find a better reason. But you can't deny the fact that it was a genuine cloth wrapped around Jesus Christ. There are still marks of lashing on that cloth. There are still marks of pricks of thorns around his head. So they say, how can you ignore these additional factors? This a complete evidence, full evidence, admissible in any court, that he had to be Jesus. Thank you. The last question?
The last question, yes, sir. Okay. Mr. John Moore, please.
Your Holiness, my name is John Moore. I'm engaged in private Catholic evangelization. The question is brief, really. As Jesus was dying on the cross, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Right? Now, last year, I had the privilege of going with a Muslim man into the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And in there, immediately inside the door, is the place where, when Jesus was taken down from the cross, he was laid on the floor, and he was covered with a cloth. However, that's not my question, but talked on it. And my question is, Jesus did say, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody can come to me, nobody can come to the Father except through me." Any comment, please?
Do you belong to Seventh-day Adventists?
No.
No. Okay, yes. Because this also is something on which they emphasize, you know. That's right. You know, I have already answered this question in answer to the question raised by our Hindu friend here when he spoke of Krishna having made the same claim, much before Jesus Christ, mind you. And I have read the fundamental books of all major religions, not all, but all major religions, and I find a reference to exactly the same in so many statements of either the prophets or the divine scriptures. The Holy Prophet has made exactly the same claim. So it is a time-related claim, you must remember. It has to be made by every prophet. Because if a prophet says, "I am not the way," then he's denying himself. He's rejecting the necessity of people finding God through him. So in Islamic terminology, in the Holy Quran, Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is mentioned as wasila, the doorway to God. So I have read that so many times. I love reading Bible as well. But because I have read other religions, so I can immediately find similarities between the style of expression. So this only means that in relation to God, a prophet becomes himself an eternal truth. Because if he speaks the language of God and God alone, then he becomes eternal. Not in person, not in relation to his human form, but in relation to his views and ideas and ideologies. So if you belong to eternal God, you must have some features of eternal God or aspects of his character transferred to you. Or your claim that you are in communion with him or you belong to him would be falsified if you can't show any signs. So these are the fundamental signs which are shown by all major prophets of the world, that we have become identified with an eternal super being. And in us you find this Alpha and Omega and the door. So I hope that should be sufficient for you to understand our viewpoint on this issue. Thank you.
That actually ends the questions, but there is a gentleman, a friend of the community, who would like to say a few words of thanks.
Most welcome.
His name is
If they are not embarrassing to me, I mean.
I'm sure.
I know some people, out of their kindness, it happened there in London, for instance, they start speaking highly of me, and I am such a humble man, you know. I was perspiring from head to foot by the time he finished. Please.
Mr. Neville Stack would like to say a few words.
Your Holiness, the words will be few and you will not perspire.
Thank you.
I've been asked, and I'm delighted to accept the honour of thanking you, sir, on behalf of all the people here who have come to be so enlightened by your depth of knowledge, your breadth of knowledge, not only of your own religion, but of others, which I think will be enlightening also to the people who are not members of your faith. your deep knowledge and the breadth of your vision and the forward-looking faith in technology as a spiritual weapon is touching to everybody who is looking to the future so eagerly with some apprehension. May I thank you also for the extremely good humour to which you tolerated our naivety, and to say how, on behalf of everybody here, very much obliged we are to you for finding the time in your worldwide travels to come to this outpost of your empire.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I agree that I'm not perspiring from head to foot, but still I have to use my handkerchief. With so much gratitude to you for your kindness and generosity. Allah bless you all. It has been a very wonderful evening I have spent with you. Thank you for sharing your time and coming here and providing this opportunity of get together and free exchange of views like gentlemen. Thank you. And ladies, of course. When we say gentlemen, you know, we also include ladies because this is a customary expression we have inherited from ages. So with due apologies to the feminists, I will still say gentlemen, in my opinion, includes all ladies. Allah bless you.